Douglas says, "There are too many monsters. Every time we kill some, more come out." Lucia says, "I hope Jimmy wasn't caught by the monsters." Oops. Avin says, "Here they come again. It's hopeless." Okay, we got a lot. Okay. Well, let's use the sonic sword on the A. Use the unlimited on B. Douglas will attack this one. And she'll also attack this one. I'm still gonna save two finishing moves for whatever boss battle there might be. Let's go after this one. Must be almost dead. That's all they were? Alright, just one monster each. Usually you see one monster and it represents like a group of monsters, so I figured we were fighting... gonna fight four groups or whatever. Oops. I wanted to go left. First. I want to make sure I can see what's over there. Avin says, "What's wrong, Matisse?" Avin says, "How can anyone be in such a dangerous place?" "Hey, you," Douglas says, "are you okay?" "Man wearing a hood." Lucia says, "Something feels wrong here." "Be careful," says Retis. "That man is a member of Octum's apostles." "Really?" says Avin. "Dark sorcerer." So he changed from a man in a hood to a dark sorcerer. The dark sorcerer began uttering an eerie chant. I'm guessing he's summoning monsters. He's been the one probably summoning the monsters in this cave. Yeah, he really likes these compy things. Well, they're the weak ones, so who really cares? Avin says, "Where did they come from?" Rutis, "It's the secret mantra from the Book of Life. The monsters are called from the warp in space." Douglas says, "Lucius, do you think you can break it?" "We must survive this. Let me try." Jimmy says, "Don't think you can keep this up, you bastard." Where's Jimmy? Oh. Backstab, Jimmy. Backstab. Nice. He might be a roguish character. Yeah, indeed. "Surrender," yells Avin. Or not. Ruti says, "He's gone." Jimmy says, "Lucius, are you hurt?" "No, I'm fine, thanks." Douglas says, "You're better than I thought, kid." Jimmy says, "I know who you are. The famous Lightning Douglas, right? And you, with the bandana, are..." "I'm Avin. This is Rutis. You saved us, Jimmy. Thank you." "Tee-hee-hee, don't mention it. You take care of yourselves on your way home. You can't disappear like me." I don't want to leave the cave. We haven't seen what's to the west of here. Lucia says, "Wait up." "Oops," says Jimmy. What? "Jump around a little," says Lucius. "Huh? What are you talking about?" "I said jump around a little." "Why should I? You can't give me orders." "What's that sound?" says Lucius. "Well, I don't feel so good in my stomach," Jimmy says. Your stomach sure makes a very interesting sound." "He's got something on him." "You should take something for that." "No thanks, Lucius. Bye!" Don't even think about it, says Lucius. Got him. Don't let go of him. What the? Says Jimmy. Once I have felt your aura, I know how to catch you. Douglas says, excellent. Damn you! Let me go, Lucius! Is this the way to thank someone who saved your life? It's a different story, Lucius says. What did you steal this time? The treasures I found at the end of the cave. A merchant called Barlack hid them there. I remember the merchant, Douglas says. He asked me to bring back the goods he kept in the cave. Avin says he was an awfully unfriendly guy. Listen, Jimmy says. Barlack is an infamously corrupt merchant. He was doing business with Great Oracle Avarice, who was arrested for bribery. Barlack's job is to convert the bribes into roses. The things he hid here were also obtained under the table. I see, Douglas says. No wonder he kept them in such a strange place. So, what I did was for a good cause. Did you get it? Don't flatter yourself, Lucius says. Mutis says, stealing is stealing. It's never good. Every time you steal something from others, you lose part of yourself. Maybe. I thought it was more like killing. In the end, your heart will be empty. Jimmy says, don't talk like you know everything. This is how I've been feeding myself ever since my parents died. You don't know anything about me. I know, says Retis. My life wasn't much different from yours. What? Retis, says Avin. Now I truly regret what I've done, Retis says. I shouldn't have sold my conscience. You're still young. Please stop doing this before you do something you regret. Lucia says, can't say anything, huh? You're just pretending to be tough. Inside, you're a spoiled kid. You're not the only one who's suffering. Douglas says, you've given him enough of a sermon. And we'll change the music back. Thanks, Douglas. By the way, Lucius, could you deliver these things to the guild? The guild should be able to return them to wherever they came from. I can do that, Lucius says. But what are you going to do? Avin says, we have some place we must go. We don't have time to return to Valkt. All right, Lucius says. Avin, Retis, thank you for helping me. Now she's going to leave the group. Glad we didn't give her the Marvel mail. I'll return the favor someday. How about me? Says Douglas. You owe me big time. I can't forget that just yet. Life is tough, Douglas says. Lucius says, hey, Jimmy, let's go back to Valkt. Okay, okay. Please don't pull my ear. Douglas says, they're gone. Alright, we should hurry on to Quitt Village, too. We've wasted so much time, says Avin. By the way, what were those Octum's apostles doing here? I don't know, says Retis, but I have a bad feeling about this. We should be careful. Can we explore the rest now? This is empty. There's nothing here. Can we go this way? See what might be over here? Thank you very much. I was afraid that we're just gonna leave the dungeon. Ah, oh, see? We got a circlet, see? Thank you, game, for letting me get the circlet at the end. So, is that under arms? No. Protector, right? No. Accessory? Head accessory with charmed gemstones embedded in the forehead part. The forehead part. Okay. Alright, let's see. Well, attack goes down, but defense and magic attack go up quite a bit. Attack goes down, we'll be taking off the power of this, that's why. Yeah, I don't want attack to go down that much. We all have power of this. The bond earrings give us a lot of cool stuff. Yeah, I really don't want to get rid of that either. Hit goes way down for that. And the forest cape really helps with avoidance. Yeah, sadly, I think we're gonna not equip that. The circle it anyway. Do we need any healing just in case something comes after us? Yeah. No, we're only a triplet again. Is that right? Triplet? Triptet? Something? Now there shouldn't be any monsters. Well, that's the one we left behind. And I didn't get a chance to. I was saving her deadly attack, and she left the group before I could even use it. Enough of that stone blast. Avin will finish this guy off that he hit, and the other two will hit this thing. And Routis will finish it off. I'm not picky. As long as someone finishes it off. I wish she didn't leave so quickly. Could we keep having these people like join for like a half hour, not even, and then leave again? It's so unpredictable sometimes. You want some food? Because you haven't been finding anything for us lately. I'm gonna praise you. Happy? I will give you red pet food. No, that's right. I know we're gonna hit a couple of them. It's kind of unavoidable. Oh, we have to cross this. Oh, we're back over. That's right. Do we go this way? No. Wait a second. Where are we? Oh, this is the way. This guy summoned all these stupid things. Okay. Are we supposed to just go on to Quitt now? We won't quit until we get to Quitt. I bet you they won't even let us go east at this point. Let me just see what they say. it's close by, so... I almost ran into that. Oh, they let us go here. I think we're supposed to go to Quitt now. Oh, now you want... Okay. I keep forgetting there's only three of us. I like having four members in the party. So I hope we run into her again. And Jimmy. It's a good roguish sort of character. Oh, it's casting rarer on itself. Wow. It's been a while since I've seen a monster heal itself. I think those El Cargo things used to do that, if I remember right, way back in the beginning. I used to hate them because they were just healing each other. For all I know, I'm thinking of Prophecy of the Moonlight Witch. West. It's close. Alright, it's gotta be right in here. No, not yet. Over here. Hi. Bashful. Does it have a foot? Oh, it looks like it has little feet. Look, they look like toes in the back. Ah. Funny. We don't get a lot of experience in the last battle with those, though, so I'm gonna skip it. I'll be skipping it. West is Quitt. East? Wait. And what's up here? And is that... Are we right outside Quitt? Or is there another screen? Because it says 162 Milos. I found those aren't really accurate. Oh. Rarest potion. Nice. That's worth it. Nope, nothing else in there. Sometimes I have a feeling if we check it twice, there might be something else in there. So, we have two rarest potions now. Wow. The last one we found was quite a while ago. Alright, so I'm guessing this is right outside, or close by anyway. How about I read those books? Just wonder if I read... 5. The Witchcraft Master, let me see. Not sure if I read it. Let's read it. Because this one, I remember. Yeah. The guy was saying how handsome he was. It seems like it has some kind of, like, titillating tendency in the writing there. Swordmaster 5. It always has this, War Chronicles. Like, as if War Chronicles is like a... like an overarching, you know, book series. And then Swordmaster is this book series. Kind of in the way that, like, War Chronicles is like the Legend of Heroes, and Swordsmaster, or Swordsmaster Zamza, whichever you prefer, is like Trails in the Sky, Trails of Cold Steel, etc. I kind of see it that way. So Volume 5, The Witchcraft Master. 10 old men crowded the tent with extravagant embroidery. These were the 10 sages of the Red Tribe. By the way, if you guys are still listening, you can tune out now if you don't want to hear me read the Swordsmaster and Quick Raven books, because I'm going to end the episode here. We'll be going into Quitt next episode. So anyway, major decisions were always made through tribal meetings. Today's topic was, of course, the enemy forces led by Milligan. Yesterday's reports clearly showed that the Red Tribe force is outnumbered by enemy force. It was becoming clear that further opposition was useless. In any case, even if Zamza is winning for now, he will be defeated in the end. He is simply outnumbered. But remember that he is the same as the underling of the Bardas Church. We cannot submit. I agree. We may end up losing this fertile land of the ancestors that we have inherited from our ancestors. Oh, sorry. This fertile land of the spirits that we have inherited from our ancestors. However, we have the advantage now. Perhaps we can work out a truce. Milligan is a conqueror, but I also hear that he is a fair man. Perhaps that is a good solution. The participants of these tribal meetings are always none other than the 10 sages. However, there was an 11th member today. None of the 10 sages has even noticed him. He has made himself invisible and undetectable. That man's name was Witchcraft Master Tempest. He was actually the mastermind behind the civil war between the people of the Red Tribe. That fact was only known to himself, though. He was over 80 years old, but only appeared to be in his 20s. That probably had to do with his powers. He didn't utter a single word in the midst of the discussion of the scraggly voices, observing the others wearing his black cloak. But he finally opened his mouth, shaking his shoulders. A truce? That's a good idea, but I can't allow that to happen. Who's there? Ha 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 ha. The old man's question was only met with laughter. The surprised 10 sages look around. Tempest opened his black cloak and released his spell of invisibility. The old man's eyes opened wide in surprise. You will still be of great use to me. For me, Tempest! Tempest exclaimed, and his eyes turned an unpleasant red color. That instant, the old men collapsed as if they lost all their strength. Their eyes became devoid of life. Wow. Yeah, I definitely didn't read that one. Okay, so Swordsmaster, Volume 6, A Turn for the Worse. The evening prior to the final battle, Zamza received a letter from the 10 sages in the tent in his camp. Zamza had sent a proposal for a truce. He expected a reply for agreement, but the message in the letter was to continue fighting. That's strange, he thought, unable to shake the feeling of suspicion. This was the first time Zamza himself was ignored in such a manner. Milligan's forces were gathering and would be a matter of time before the battlefield will be covered. Bad grammar there. Zamza could not shake his suspicion and then realized something. It was too quiet. He was about to go out of his tent to check on things when his subordinate, Reebel, appeared at his entrance. Reebel, good timing. I was about to call for you. Zamza's words were off with the slash of a sword by Reebel. What's the meaning of this, Reebel? Zamza dodged Reebel's attacks but had no intention of fighting. Zamza continued dodging the lunges and slashes. After a while of this interaction, Zamza noticed that Reebel's eyes were empty. Oh, doesn't even have a period at the end. Mabel's eyes are empty. Alright. Alright, we're caught up with the Swordmaster books. Quick Raven 3. I think we read this. Just check. Interception. I don't remember this. I don't remember reading this. Let's read 3, 4, and 5. Okay. Quick Raven Volume 3, Interception. Karamuro Karamis. Running as fast as he can, Raven yelled at his partner, "Marl, let's lead them to somewhere with more room." "Okay," Marl answered with his blonde hair waving in the wind. Although they were able to take back the ancient book, they ended up with the thieves chasing after them. They defeated two of the thieves when they took the book. Unable to move in the narrow cavern, Raven and Marl escaped the three remaining thieves and ran down the steep mountainside. Raven carried the book under his arm as he cleverly weaved through the trees. "What is it with this book?" Raven thought, with the ancient book in his hands. He heard the voices and footsteps coming after him. A request from the royal family that was filled with secrecy, the mysterious hymn that the thieves were talking about. Is this a book of such importance? When the two were just running out of breath, they broke through the trees into a clearing. The area was fine to swing a sword or throw a boomerang. They glanced around their surroundings as they waited for their pursuers. "Okay, Marl, let's take care of them." As Raven finished his sentence, the excited men came running into the clearing. Finally giving up, the three thieves readied their swords and attacked the two adventurers. The battle began again. It wasn't very difficult for the two adventurers who maintained their calmness to defeat the excited thieves. Raven sheathed his sword. Three men lay at his feet. "We're going to be in trouble if someone finds us. Let's get out of here," Raven said, brushing his hair away. They were close to the main passage. The two were about to leave the area quickly. Suddenly, a dignified voice stopped the two adventurers. "Stop right there!" Alright. Two more. Quick Raven 4. Dark Eyes. The two turn around, ready for action. Long black hair waving in the wind was the first thing that entered their vision. "Hand over the book." The calm voice sounded again. A young girl with black hair turned her dark eyes to the two adventurers. Raven and Marl couldn't hide their surprise, but returning her straightforward gaze, Raven replied, "No." The girl with black hair held out her pale hand to Raven without changing her expression. The hand was asking for the book to be handed over. "That book is too much for you two to handle. Power you cannot control will destroy you. Hand over the book." Raven was taken aback by the girl's ambiance, but he managed to ask, "Who are you? And what is it about this book?" The girl narrowed her black eyes. "There are many things in this world that you don't need to know about. It's okay. I'll come for the book another day." The girl walked past the two and started walking toward the passage. Raven and Marl exchanged glances. At that moment, the girl disappeared. Raven threw a questioning look at Marl. Marl just cocked his head to the side. "What was that?" The wind carried Raven's mutter to his partner's ears. "I'll come from the book another day." The another day that the girl mentioned was actually not another day, but the same day. Okay. And Quick Raven 5, A Chorus of Insects. The two were lodging at the capital that evening. They still had not returned the book they took from the thieves. Under normal circumstances, they would have returned the book to the rightful owner. But they were concerned about the strange encounter earlier that day. What was the importance of this book? Who was that young girl? If they were to return the book, they would never be able to get the answers. Later in the evening, Raven turned to the bed next to his. "Marl, are you asleep?" Summer insects sang their songs outside the window. After a while, Marl replied, "Nah, there's no way I could sleep." In parentheses, each of them told themselves. They were worn out physically, but their curiosity completely blew away any possibility of sleep. The two lay there for a while without saying a thing, waiting for time to pass. When Raven was replaying the events during the day in his mind. "She's here," Marl whispered. The songs of the insects had stopped. The next moment, the window was blown away with a large sound. The two jumped to their feet as if they were expecting this. "Sorry to keep you waiting." The girl from earlier that day appeared in front of the two adventurers who were poised for action. "You were expecting me?" The girl threw a sharp knife at Raven without even waiting for a reply. Raven reached for the sword next to him, and with a sharp metallic sound, the knife fell to the ground. When Marl was beginning to cast his spell to assist Raven, a sharp pain shot through Marl's back and his face contorted in pain. Marl gasped. The intense pain forced grunt from his throat. There was a sorcerer dressed in black standing in the doorway. Raven lit the lamp nearby. "Marl!" The girl that was facing Raven suddenly yelled at the sorcerer. "Doric? This is my job." "Very interesting. Anyway, thanks so much for watching, guys. See you in the next episode. Next time, we'll be entering the town or village of Quitt. See you next time, and always seek adventure."